slaves or women or many categories of people.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. The legal definition of personhood has fluctuated over history.
As included corporations.
Yes, and I know that one always gets me. That one is so strange. Yeah. So we can see that there's different definitions of personhood. Some of them are philosophical. Some of them are legal. I want to show you that any definition of a person that doesn't include all human beings is the very definition of a human rights violation. Whenever we say that to be a person, to have rights, you have to be a human being plus X, that's the very formula for a grave injustice, the very formula for a human rights violation. And as he mentioned, we can see throughout history that every time that we've said you have to be a human being plus X, it's been a catastrophic moral error. For example, in the United States, Black people were dehumanized in order to justify the evils of slavery. In the US, in order to be a person, you had to be a human being plus white skin. Or here, a person was a human being plus non-indigenous. And we know both of these things today as racism. In Great Britain, furthermore, as well as here in Canada, actually, women were termed not persons under the law and were denied civil rights like the right to vote. Here, to be a person, you had to be a human being plus male. And we know this today as sexism. Or what about taking it back a little bit closer in history? When we look at the Holocaust in Nazi Germany, Jews were denied personhood in order to, under the law, in order to justify the atrocities of the Holocaust. Here, in order to be a person, you had to be a human being plus non-Jew. And we know this today as anti-Semitism. Yet our own Supreme Court says that the law of Canada does not recognize the unborn child as a legal person possessing rights. To be a person in Canada, you have to be a human being plus a certain age. This is merely ageism. This is age-based discrimination. Whenever we see this pattern that to be a person you need to be a human being plus X, it's the very pattern of a human rights violation. With abortion, it's human plus a certain age, and it's just age-based discrimination. It's just ageism. And this ageism has lethal consequences. I'm going to show you a video. The video includes footage of abortions and of abortion victims. It is not easy to watch. And if you need to close your eyes or look away, you can, and you'll know that the footage has ended when the music stops playing. If you can, though, I really encourage you to not look away and to watch. We need to understand the consequences of denying human beings the right to life. And we need to understand what's at stake with abortion.
Thank you.
just saw does not unrape the rape victim. It doesn't make the poor woman rich. And it doesn't prevent two people from becoming parents. It just makes them the parents of a dead child. When we ignore the facts and when we stay silent about this issue, the reality is that 300 preborn children are dismembered, decapitated, and disemboweled every day in our country. Abortion is legal through all 9 months of pregnancy. We have no laws against it in our nation. And we're talking about innocent human lives that are at stake. Broken bodies with no identity, not even a name. And although pro-lifers who take this footage in abortion clinics are sometimes able to take the children's remains to provide them with a dignified burial, so often those children wind up as medical waste. You may be thinking, I agree with you, you know, I'm pro-life, but we can't force our opinions on other people. It's still her life, it's her choice. What I've presented you, though, about is the truth about abortion, grounded in science and human rights. This is not just my opinion, this is the reality. And when we recognize that in a situation someone is being harmed, shouldn't we speak up? When an action harms another innocent human, shouldn't we take action? I'd like to share a quick story with you from when I was doing pro-life work this summer about what happens when we show up and speak up, and about what happens when we're absent and silent. I have a friend, Irene, who's a wonderful person. She's an amazing pro-life advocate. She's been doing activism for years, even though she's just our age. And she was traveling with some of my friends to Hamilton nearby to do Choice Chain. Some of you have seen me do, have done Choice Chain yourselves, where we stand with images of abortion victims and we engage in peaceful dialogue with the public. And Irene talked to a woman who told her that she was pro-choice in favor of abortion. And they had a conversation about the humanity and the human rights of the preborn child. That woman revealed to Irene that she herself was pregnant. She had an abortion scheduled for that week. But at the end of the conversation, she hugged Irene and thanked her for being there, and said that after seeing those images and hearing about the humanity of the preborn child, she couldn't do that to her child. By the grace of God working through my friend Irene, a baby's life was saved that day. I saw Irene later that week back in Toronto, and I told her how overjoyed I was and all my friends were about the baby who was saved. And she said to me, "Maria, that was one of the hardest choice chains I've ever done," and she's done many. And I asked why. She told me that there was another woman who approached her at that choice chain. And she asked the woman, "What do you think about abortion?" And the woman stopped and looked at my friend's signs and said, "Where were you yesterday? Where were you yesterday when I had an abortion?" That question bothers me a lot. And I invite you to let it bother you too. Because this is not a movement. This is an emergency. With 100,000 abortions happening in Canada every year, and with more than 3 million since its legalization, that's also a lot of women who are hurting. And who are these women? Some of them are strangers on the street whom Irene encountered. Some of them are strangers I've encountered doing outreach here on campus. But many of them are closer to home. They're our friends, our teachers, our classmates, our mothers, our girlfriends, our sisters. Maybe they're even us. And it's important to remember that while we have to condemn the act of abortion, that there is always hope for people who have had abortions. And it is important to remember that we must always show love and compassion to those who have been wounded by abortion, because only love can heal a wounded heart. If you or anyone you know is struggling after an abortion, please know that I am here and all of Western Lifeline is here to walk with you and to listen to you. And I encourage you to look at some of the resources that are on our website. They're listed on your handout. In particular, Silent No More is a ministry that connects post-abortive individuals with aftercare programs. And it allows men and women to share their story, if they so choose, as they move towards healing and forgiveness. And it was started by my friend Angelina, who was a post-abortive rape victim and mourns the loss of her daughter, Sarah. We have a deeply wounded culture, and your voice is needed more than ever to reach out to the wounded and to stand up for the voiceless. You may be wondering, how can we share a truth that is so hard to hear, so hard to accept, a truth that we know will not be always responded to positively? And the answer to that question is that in order to truly love someone, you have to be truthful with them. Truth and love must always go hand in hand. And as my friend Devorah has said, truth without love is ineffective, but love without truth is a lie. Maybe you're still thinking, though, that abortion could be acceptable out of fear, because an unplanned pregnancy is really scary. A teenager's pictured here with the caption, "My mom is going to kill me, and she's pregnant." Will her mom actually physically kill her because of her pregnancy? No, I would certainly hope not. And if you knew that her mom was going to do that, wouldn't you try to stop her? I certainly hope so. If this woman has an abortion, though, will that actually physically kill her child? Yes, it would. So if it wouldn't be okay for this girl's mother to kill her because of an unplanned pregnancy, why would it be okay for her to have someone kill her preborn child for the same reason? And someone may say, well, Maria, because it's hard. It's just really, really hard. And that's why I'd like us to remember how we started. Inspiring people and being inspired by other people, doing the right thing, even though it's the hard thing. Let us remind each other as we share the pro-life message, and let us remind women who are facing the difficulties of pregnancy that they are braver than they think and stronger than they think. And let us remind each other that we can do the right thing, even though it's the hard thing. Maybe you're wondering, I know I always wondered at the end of pro-life presentations, what now? What are we supposed to do to end abortion? Someone may say, and people have told me, well, we need to change the laws, Maria. And I would definitely agree that legislative change is absolutely necessary on abortion. How many people, though, follow copyright law? I don't think I do. I'm pretty sure I've photocopied more than 10% of a book before, probably. Or how many people follow laws on pot and underage drinking? We know that if people don't respect the law, they won't follow the law. And so although legislative change is crucial, we need to change our culture before we're capable of changing the law. This happens conversation by conversation, friend by friend, club by club, school by school, city by city. Pro-life students are already doing this in London and across the nation. In two ways. They're having effective conversations about abortion, and they are presenting compelling evidence. You can see, for example, Western Lifeline here on the right, and that's London Against Abortion on the left doing a choice chain at the gates. So here are two things you can do today to help end the killing in our nation. First of all, I invite you to attend, if you're able, Western Lifeline's meetings on Mondays at 5:30, just around the corner in UCC 54A, and that is on your handout. At our meetings, you can not only meet other pro-lifers and sometimes get free pizza, but we also help to equip you further to share the pro-life message with compassion and conviction. And secondly, I invite you to sign up for Lifeline's weekly email list, where every week we let you know of the opportunities there are to stand up for the preborn. Everything from volunteering at fundraisers for our local crisis pregnancy center to doing outreach on campus like Garrett is here. Your voice is needed to reach out in truth and love. Your voice is needed to save the lives of the youngest of the human family. So to conclude, I just have three simple questions. By a show of hands, who here can walk? Sweet. Who here can talk? Excellent. then you have what it takes to stand up for the preborn and their mothers. And the final question, don't need a show of hands, but I invite you to consider it, is will you? Thank you, everyone. Now we have a stump a pro-lifer. I know that if you have to leave at 6, that's totally fine. We do have the room until 6:30. So are there any questions?
I'll have a question after my first sort of statement. You sort of mentioned earlier in your presentation about disabilities with the pregnancy, and I sort of wanted to give my own personal story about this. When I was conceived, my hands and feet were wet.
Okay.
And the doctor said that I had Edwards syndrome, which I believe is a form of Down syndrome.
Okay.
And throughout my mom's entire pregnancy, they were basically telling her to abort me, abort me, abort me, abort me, over and over and over again. And for her, it was never an option. Abortion is never going to be an option for me. And they kept saying, he's going to grow up very, very, like, abused and bullied and all this due to his disabilities. But when I was born out of my mom's womb, the doctor looked at me and said, he is a healthy, perfectly normal boy.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something that I think, in terms of relating to disabilities, the doctors can be wrong.
Exactly.
In terms of looking into the mother's womb, and that's no excuse for aborting a child.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing that I hear often, especially in my program, which is very biased towards the pro-choice movement, is they do recognize the humanity of the baby, but they say that abortion is a necessary and effective means of population control, and that pro-lifers who do these abortion activist stuff are pro-birth and rather than pro-life. They want the baby born, and then who the hell cares after that? So I have some ways of defending this, but they're relatively weak, so I want to know, how would I defend a case against these specific arguments here?
Sure, well, that's a good question. Because it's two separate things, I would say, the overpopulation and the pro-birth thing, I'll address it as two separate questions. When it comes to overpopulation, you can do a simple move that's called trotting out the toddler. And you can test whether their theory that abortion is okay for population control, whether they would apply that to born humans. So sometimes it's a toddler, sometimes it's older. So one time I asked a person, I would establish common ground. I won't say I agree with you that overpopulation is a problem, because that's a debatable thing. But I would say something like, I appreciate that you're someone who cares about the earth and wants there to be enough resources for all of us. When it comes to overpopulation, would you ever say that a solution to overpopulation would be to, for example, kill all the homeless people in Toronto or kill all the homeless people in China, a very heavily populated country? Most people will say no, and then you can follow that up with a question. Okay, I agree with you. If it wouldn't be okay to kill a born human because of overpopulation, why would it be okay to kill a human being before birth? And that kind of question can, even though people will say that they admit the humanity of the child, I've found very frequently that people don't actually believe it. They haven't internalized that. And so that question can expose presuppositions and move you into examining, what relevant differences do you think there are between a born human and a preborn human? With the question of pro-birth, there's a thing in conversations that my friend calls being proactive rather than being reactive. So when someone says you're pro-birth and you don't care about children after they're born, every ounce of me wants to say, how do you know? Have you followed my schedule to see the volunteering I do? Do you see how I treat other human beings? Like, how on earth do you know that? That's actually a very reactive way of responding. And so I like to respond charitably proactive and say, my argument as a pro-lifer is that it is wrong to kill an innocent human being because human beings have human rights. Whether or not I'm a good person, whether or not I care for all born human beings, how does that affect whether or not I'm correct? And one way you could ask is another kind of questioning would be, there are all sorts of children in the foster care system right now, and I'm not capable of adopting them all to get them out of the foster care system. Would you ever say then that it would be okay to kill all the kids in the foster care system because I'm not able to care for them? Yeah, so just the question of pro-life versus pro-birth is really just an ad hominem argument, and you can respond charitably, proactively by saying, sure, you know, maybe I am, let's say for the sake of argument that I am a hypocrite who doesn't help born human beings, although that's probably up for debate. How does that determine whether or not it's okay to dismember and disembowel a pre-born human being? Yeah, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This may be a separate topic in itself.
That's
but
okay.
One of the other arguments for pro-choice would be that, let's say the child doesn't, maybe they're going to be born with a disability, like paralysis. And one of the, if the child is already born, they're going to say, oh, they're going to have a difficult life, they won't even be able to speak their own voice. So this ties in very closely with euthanasia.
Mm-hmm.
And when, even if they consider that they are a human being, they still will do euthanasia even after it's born. Okay. So what would be an argument against that? That might be a separate topic in itself.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say?
So yeah, the question of euthanasia, I guess, for born children, where someone is saying no, I would still kill a human being. I think the first thing you could do is to test that to see whether they really believe it. And you could ask something like, I think that the question of euthanasia is a controversial topic. Couldn't we agree at least though that you can't euthanize someone without their consent? And I had one woman who was very pro euthanasia who said, well, yeah, of course not. That's just murder. Euthanizing someone without their consent. And then I'll say, okay, so with a preborn child, how on earth could they give consent to being killed in the womb? And so that's one way of testing whether or not they believe that. Or you could just bring out infanticide and say, okay, well, would you go into the cancer ward of young children with cancer, and would you kill them all because they have cancer? So that's one way of just testing to see whether they really believe that. With someone who's struggling a little bit more and saying, No, I think even for like a born child that euthanasia might be the right option. One thing I might say to them in conversation is, let's imagine that you have a loved one who's going to die in 3 weeks, has a terminal illness, they just found out they're gonna die in 3 weeks. Would you wait until week 2, day 6, to go and visit them? And most people would say, no, of course not. You would visit them earlier. You would try to maximize the amount of time you have left with this person, showering them with love, showering them with your love. So when it comes to a child who may not live long after birth, why would we cut short the time we have with them? Why wouldn't we shower them with love while they're in existence? One of my friend of a friend, her baby was going to die shortly after birth, like it was a terminal diagnosis. And she said that, I took this as the opportunity to realize that I can't save my child, but for a little while longer, I can provide a safe environment for my child and love him while he's with me. But why would we cut that short? Then if it gets into a deeper question of like, well, actually, I think it's okay to kill anyone if they're suffering too much, that actually, most people don't actually have that viewpoint. And I would say that that would require a different approach. That would require questions of what you might call the heart apologetics, where you're asking, you seem like someone who cares a lot about the suffering of human beings. And do you know someone who's suffered a lot? And questions like that have sometimes will bring up that maybe there's a painful thing in this person's past where they think that death is better than suffering. Does that answer your question? Okay, cool. Other questions?
How do you defend exposing graphics to your children?
Oh, that's a good question. So first of all, in my activism, and I think in the activism of any pro-life group, we never target children. For example, there's no children in this audience. When we take images into public, because it's a public space, there is always the risk that children will be present. And if, like the other day when I was doing Trace Chain, a big group of kids walked by, and so we just closed up the signs, because we don't target people who can't even have abortions yet. We target anyone like 12 and over, because they can have an abortion, so they should be able to see it. When it's the question of like, well, okay, but yes, some kids are still going to see it. We know that these images save lives. John was the man, the guy who to whom another man came up and told us that, oh, because of your choice chain, my granddaughter drove by it on her way to her abortion, and she canceled her abortion appointment on her way there because she saw it. And so we know that these images could hurt a child's feelings, but don't lives trump feelings? If you were walking with a young child and you saw another kid being molested in the street, what would be your first response? Would it be to go and help that child and stop the violence, or would it be to cover your child's eyes and say, "Don't look, sweetie"? These broken bodies are everywhere. We just lift up the bin covers. And a more extensive defense of AVP could take like a good hour because there's all sorts of little objections. But yeah, I would say that we know that there's nothing wrong with exposing injustice. The Bible actually tells us, you know, expose the deeds done in darkness. So it's not an immoral act to show a graphic image. And then if it could have some negative consequences, we have to weigh those negative consequences against the greater positive consequences of saved lives, the lives from feelings. Yeah. Kind of a case of the principle of double effect, not consequentialism, if anyone is interested. Other questions? I'm also, I don't have class till 7, so if you have any questions that you wanted to ask, like, privately, I know sometimes you can be uncomfortable, feel free to ask me. Yeah, thanks, guys.